In this module, we will define various anatomical planes and sections of the body. Once completed with this module, you should be able to identify the planes and sections of the body and define directional and positional terms used in anatomical landmarking. When defining anatomical structures in the body, it can be helpful to utilize anatomical landmarks or to look at these structures from a specific point of view. To facilitate some of our future discussions on anatomy and physiology, we need to first identify planes and sections of the human body. These planes are essentially cross-sections of the body that allow us to view anatomical structures from consistent, standardized perspectives. At the onset, it is important to begin with a standardized view of the human body so that references to anatomical structures and landmarks are consistent. This is the purpose of what is known as anatomic position. In this position, the person is standing, facing the provider, with the arms at the side, palms forward, toward the provider, and the thumbs pointing away from the body. The frontal, or coronal, plane splits the body in half along a vertical axis between the front and back. Imagine a thin sheet of glass that slices the body from the head to the feet, from ear to ear, separating the front of the body from the back. The front aspect of the body is referred to as the ventral section, and the back portion is the dorsal section. For the next plane, we will split the body vertically again, but this time, rather than splitting the body between front and back, the plane will divide the body between left and right. This sagittal or lateral plane does not necessarily need to split the body evenly from left to right. It can be offset to one side or the other. If this imaginary line or plane, referred to as the sagittal axis, does indeed split the patient evenly into left and right halves, running down the center of the nose and navel, the plane is referred to as mid-sagittal or the midline. Generally speaking, moving away from the mid-sagittal axis is called lateral, although the two separate sides can be further defined by either left or right. In doing so, however, it is important to use the patient's, not the provider's, left and right. If we split the body horizontally along the waist, separating the top of the body from the bottom, this creates the transverse or axial plane. The top section of the body given this transverse plane is referred to as the cranial section. The bottom section is the caudal section. When using medical imagery, these different planes or perspectives are used to take either cross-sections or longitudinal sections of the body. A cross-section is one taken horizontally across the body, parallel to the transverse plane. A longitudinal section is taken across the length or longer portion of the body, parallel with either the frontal or sagittal plane. Returning back to anatomical position, we should also look at some terms used to locate or describe body parts, organs, and features in relation to other anatomical landmarks. As you move up and down the body, between the feet and head, features located closer to the head are superior to those that are located closer to the feet, and those closer to the feet are inferior to those that are closer to the head. Moving between the front and back of the body, features toward the front of the body are anterior to those toward the back, and those toward the back are posterior to those toward the front. While the terms ventral and dorsal could be used for anterior and posterior respectively, those terms are used more frequently when referring to the anatomy of other animals, not humans. Once again, referencing the midline, the mid-sagittal plane, as you move away from the midline, features further away from the midline are lateral to those that are closer. Inversely, features that are closer to the midline are medial to those that are further away. When dealing with the extremities, features further away from the body's core are distal to those that are closer, while features closer to the body's core are proximal to those that are further away, those that are closer to the hands or feet. Lastly, we also need to recognize movement in and out of the body, from the surface of the skin into the core of the body and vice versa. Anything closer to the exterior surface of the skin is superficial to features closer to the core. Those closer to the core are considered deep to those closer to the exterior of the skin. Where joints are involved in the extremities, moving a distal point of an extremity toward the trunk of the body is called flexion. inversely moving or extending that distal point of an extremity from a flexed position to a more neutral or anatomical position away from the trunk of the body is called extension. The anatomical position that we discussed earlier in the module has all of the extremities in extension. If a joint flexes too far, it is said to have suffered from hyperflexion. Inversely, hyperextension occurs when a joint extends beyond its maximum level, which typically means bending backward. In reference to the body's midline, moving an extremity away from the midline is called abduction. If it helps, while somewhat corny, think of it as an alien abduction. If abducted by aliens, a person is taken away from the Earth. It is the same with abduction in this context, only the extremity is being moved away from the midline. Inversely, returning or moving an extremity to the midline is adduction. Think of it as adding the extremity to the midline, thus it is called adduction. There are also some additional positional terms that we will quickly define here. To supinate is to turn the palm of the hands up, and to pronate is to turn the palm of the hands down. When rotating a limb, internal rotation occurs when the limb is rotated toward the midline, and external rotation is when the limb is rotated away from the midline of the body. Body parts or conditions that appear or occur on both sides of the body's midline simultaneously are said to be bilateral. The eyes and lungs are common examples of bilateral organs in the body. Body parts or conditions that appear or occur on only one side of the body are unilateral. The spleen only exists on the left side of the body, therefore it is a unilateral organ. Abdominal pain on only one side of the body is unilateral pain. If two things exist or occur on the same side of the body, they are ipsilateral. If they are occurring on opposite sides of the body, then they are contralateral. A person suffering from a stroke affecting the left side of the brain, for instance, would commonly have left-sided facial drooping, meaning the facial drooping is ipsilateral to the side of the brain injury, while extremity weakness would occur on the right side of the body, contralateral to the side of the brain injury. That completes this module on planes and sections of the body, and you should now be able to identify the different planes and sections of the body and define directional and positional terms used when describing anatomical features of the body in relationship to other body regions or areas. This presentation was prepared by Waukesha County Technical College in Pewaukee, Wisconsin, and is distributed with an attribution, non-commercial, share-alike 4.0 International Creative Commons license. Copyright 2019, Waukesha County Technical College. For information on WCTC's numerous fire and EMS educational offerings, please visit us online at wctc.edu.